Good morning. Let's learn about electric potential energy.
Flippin' physics.
Okay, let's say there exists one point mass in the universe, and let's call it mass one. Infinitely far away from mass one, let's say there now exists a second point mass, mass two. Now, let's have an external force move mass 2 at a constant velocity such that the final distance between the two point masses is r with a subscript of 1, 2. That two-mass system now has a gravitational potential energy which equals the negative of the universal gravitational constant,
big G,
times mass 1 times mass 2 all divided by distance r 1, 2. The work done by the external force to move mass 2 at a constant velocity from r initial, which is an infinite distance, to r final, which is distance r 1, 2, is equal to the change in gravitational potential energy of the two-mass system, or gravitational potential energy final minus gravitational potential energy initial. We can substitute in the equation for gravitational potential energy for both the initial and final gravitational potential energies. And we can substitute in r12 for the final distance and infinity for the initial distance. And you can see the work done on the two-mass system by an external force moving mass 2 at a constant velocity from an infinite distance to a distance r12 does equal the gravitational potential energy of the two-mass system.
Mr. P?
Yes, Billy?
If mass 1 and mass 2 are the only two objects that exist in the universe, how could there be an external force on mass 2?
That is a fair question, Billy. This is really just a thought experiment and not actually possible.
It is not actually possible?
No, there are more than two point masses in this universe.
Right, but how would mass 1 not move as an external force moves mass 2 toward mass 1?
Again, this is a thought experiment, but yes, there would need to be an external force acting on mass 1 to keep it from moving. However, that force would not actually do work on mass 1 because mass 1 would not have any displacement. I feel like y'all are getting tripped up by the thought experiment part of this.
But how would a constant force keep mass 2 moving at a constant velocity?
It does not say the external force is constant. It says the velocity of mass 2 is constant. As the two masses get closer to one another, the external force would need to increase to keep mass 2 moving at a constant velocity.
Sure, that makes sense. But why is the gravitational potential energy zero when the two masses are infinitely far apart?
That is how gravitational potential energy is defined. Essentially, as a scientific community, we have decided to identify the location where the gravitational potential energy for a two-point mass system equals zero as when the two-point masses are infinitely far from one another.
Okay. Also, why is the work negative?
Let's address that. The reason the work done by an external force to move mass 2 at a constant velocity from an infinite distance from mass 1 to a distance r12 from mass 1 is negative is because it takes negative work to move mass 2 at a constant velocity. Without the external force, mass 2 would accelerate toward mass 1 because they are attracted to one another. And mass 2 would also have kinetic energy when it arrives at its final position. The external force removes energy from the two-mass system. This is why the work is negative. Well, and because the external force on mass 2 is directed away from mass 1, and the displacement of mass 2 is toward mass 1, so the force and displacement are opposite in direction, which makes the angle in the work equation 180 degrees, and the cosine of 180 degrees is negative 1.
Okay, yeah, sure, but you said we were learning about electric potential energy. This is all about gravitational potential energy. And I feel like this is pretty much review of stuff we learned already, right?
Right. I went through all this stuff involving mass and gravitational potential energy specifically because it is a review. And honestly, all of this is a bit abstract. So connecting it to mass and gravitational potential energy should help you understand what we're about to go through involving charge and electric potential energy.
Oh boy!
Okay,
sure.
Let's say there exists one point charge in the universe and let's call it charge Q1. Infinitely far away from that charge, there now exists a second point charge, Q2. an external force moves Q2 at a constant velocity such that the final distance between the two point charges is R12. That two-charge system now has an electric potential energy, which is equal to the Coulomb constant.
Little K?
Sure. Times charge 1 times charge 2, all divided by the distance between the two charges, which is R12.
Hold up.
Yes, Bo?
Where did the negative go? I mean, this looks very similar to the equation for universal gravitational potential energy, but there is no negative.
Right. I'm glad you recognize the similarities and see this equation does not have the negative sign. That is great. But please have a few moments of patience. I will address that very soon.
Sure. Patience. I can have patience.
Good.
Yeah.
The work done by the external force to move charge 2 at a constant velocity from the initial position and infinite distance from charge 2 to the final positions, a distance R12 from charge 1, is equal to the change in electric potential energy of the two-charge system, or electric potential energy final minus electric potential energy initial. We can substitute in the equation for electric potential energy for both the initial and final electric potential energies, and we can substitute in R12 for the final distance and infinity for the initial distance. And you can see the work done on the two-charge system by an external force moving charge 2 at a constant velocity from an infinite distance to a distance R12 equals the electric potential energy of the two-charge system. And this time, there is no negative in the equation.
Yeah.
Now, while there are a lot of similarities between how gravitational and electric forces and energy's function, a major difference is that mass cannot be negative, while charge can be positive or negative, and all masses are attracted to one another. But unlike charges are attracted to one another, and like charges are repelled from one another. For example, two masses always have positive mass and are always attracted to one another. However, two positive charges are repelled from one another, and two negative charges are repelled from one another. However, one positive charge and one negative charge are attracted to one another.
I get that, but how does that affect whether the electric potential energy equation is positive or negative?
We are almost there. Just a little more patience, please, Bo. If both charge 1 and charge 2 have a positive charge, let's just call it positive Q to make this simple, the work done by the external force and the change in electric potential energy is positive. And if both charge 1 and charge 2 have a negative charge, again, let's just call it negative Q to make this simple, the work done by the external force and the change in electric potential energy is still positive because negative 1 times negative 1 equals positive 1. However, if charge 1 has a positive charge, positive Q, and charge 2 has a negative charge, negative Q, or charge 1 has a negative charge, negative Q, and charge 2 has a positive charge, positive Q, the work done by the external force and the change in electric potential energy is negative, because negative 1 times positive 1 equals negative 1.
Okay, I see how the math works out, but what does that mean?
Good question, Bo. When the two charges have unlike signs, the reason the work done by an external force to move charge 2 at a constant velocity from an infinite distance from charge 1 to a distance R12 from charge 1 is negative is because it takes negative work to move charge 2 at a constant velocity. Without the external force, charge 2 would accelerate towards charge 1. Therefore, charge 2 would also have kinetic energy when it arrives at its final position. The external force removes energy from the two-charge system. That is why the work is negative when the two charges are opposite in sign. And when the two charges have like signs, the reason the work done by an external force to move charge 2 at a constant velocity from an infinite distance from charge 1 to a distance R12 from charge 1 is positive is because it takes positive work to move charge 2 closer to charge 1. Without the external force, charge 2 would accelerate away from charge 1 and the two-charge system would have less electric potential energy. The external force adds energy to the two-charge system. That is why the work is positive when the two charges have the same sign.
Okay, so it turns out that in this specific thought experiment situation, When the two charges have opposite signs, the equation for electric potential energy mathematically works out to have the negative sign in it. And when the two charges have the same sign, the equation for electric potential energy mathematically works out to not have the negative sign in it. And that is because when the two charges have opposite signs, the external force does negative work on the two charge system. And when the two charges have the same sign, the external force does positive work on the two charge system. And the gravitational potential energy version of the equation always has the negative in it because two masses are always attracted to one another. So the external force always does negative work on the two mass system.
Exactly. How did that patience work out for you, Bo?
I think I did pretty well.
Sure.
Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoyed learning with you.